A lot of times people get down on themselves because they feel like they've been through things, they come from certain backgrounds where they don't have access, not privilege, but they could just look at me as an example. You know, my mother passed away, was single household, experienced a lot of racism, like I got beat up by 4 police officers and arrested for like no fault of my own. I live in the public housing, which has a lot of crime. A bullet went to my house one time when I was younger, into my sister's room. People that I know have killed other people, have gotten killed. I come from a background where people don't expect that they can reach the heights, but I was living in the same neighborhood, you know, making different decisions.
Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. Today we're talking with Esco, who is a senior software engineer at Airbnb. We'll be talking about how he broke into tech without a CS degree and without doing a boot camp. Hope you enjoy the video. Hey Esco, how are you? Can I come in?
Yeah, sure.
Awesome.
Hey, I'm Esco. I'm a senior software engineer at Airbnb. I live in Brooklyn, New York, Bed-Stuy. Started a group for black software engineers on Facebook to help study algorithms, data structures, and that's kind of what I do as a hobby as well. What I love the most about software development is that you can kind of build anything you want. Like, you can imagine something and you can just go build it. Growing up, my family was pretty lax. There was like no pressure to like perform academically or anything like that. It was just like I was doing good already by default. My mom, she noticed that I wanted a computer. So she got me a computer with a tax refund because we didn't have a bunch of money. We grew up in public housing. And that's when I started experimenting. I wanted to be an animator when I was young, like 14. A friend of mine had shown me how to get this program called Flash, Adobe Flash, well, Mac Media at the time. So I was using it to try to make this animation. I wanted to make a ball bounce. And it was like so tedious, frame by frame. So I was looking up tutorials how to do it faster. And it was something called ActionScript. It's kind of like JavaScript, but it's for Flash. And it was so cool because you can just put code in this panel and you can interact with the graphics that you created. And you change the X and the Y position. And I was familiar from math school where they have quadrants. It was so intuitive and it was kind of easy to understand. And that's how I got into it. Because I was like, oh wow, this is amazing. I can just make things move. And I started experimenting with it from that point on. I just fell in love with it. At the time I was applying to schools, my mom was sick in the hospital, and you know, eventually she passed away. I was a single mother household, so we didn't have much funds. So I didn't apply to any colleges that I wanted to because they had application fees. The ones that had a waiver, that made it clear to me, that's the ones I applied to. And one of them was NYU Tandon, which was called Polytechnic University back then. So I applied to that school and a few other ones where it was free to apply to, and I got into the Polytech school, which was like well-known and prestigious, so I was excited about that. Studying computer science in college was cool. It kind of showed that my studying from high school and before that kind of like helped me get a jump start because I was doing well on the labs. I was getting like A's in school, things like that. Then I just started kind of doing my own thing, like coding my own stuff, not even paying attention. The main reason why I left college was financial because I couldn't afford it. I had to actually work full time while being in college to like living expenses and things like that and paying for tuition. So I was actually working as a software engineer already. As a freelance contractor full-time while in school, trying to build my own startup and then also trying to get a degree to become a software engineer. And then spending so much money and not being able to afford it, having to spend so much hours working, it didn't really make too much sense to me. So I kind of all added up and made it more easy to leave. Cool, let's just start playing. Here's some shit to think about. Hit the cliff, 100 racks at the bank account. This one in particular is about when I hit the cliff. So when you join a tech company, for example, not just tech in general, but when you ever get equity compensation, there's something called a cliff. So you have to wait for a year before you actually vest any equity. Investing means that you actually get rights to own the stock. So after you reach that cliff, you start vesting them monthly. I used to live in the Amberley in downtown Brooklyn, so I'll talk about that a little bit. That was the deep voice you heard, the security guard. Part of the story. My first like corporate gig was at the New York Times as a senior software engineer. And then from there, I had left to build a startup called Go Thrive, which is in the healthy eating space with a restaurant delivery. And then afterwards, I went to Uber, focusing more on Uber Rush, which is now mostly Uber Eats. A lot of the tech there is used for Uber Eats. And then I went to build my own company in the crypto space for about almost 2 years. And then I went back in full time, ended up back at Uber. And then afterwards, most recently, I went to Airbnb. When I was at the New York Times, before I left to do that startup, I got a reach out from a Google recruiter. He was like, the title says strong interest from Google. I was like, whoa, what's strong interest for me? And that really just put a switch on my mind that I could actually apply to these big companies like Facebook, Google. For me, I just feel like it never really clicked, like, oh, I could actually work there. Like, I guess I didn't feel like I was qualified to work there in that sense. Like when I had first started doing interviews that actually tested for legal type things, it was this company called Codecademy. And on the phone, he said, don't worry, we don't ask any crazy algorithms or anything like that. And I was like, okay, good. So I went for the interview and they asked me like a legal type question. And I was like, oh, they said no algorithms. They had the most basic algorithms questions you can have. And I was like not prepared at all. I was like doing infinite loops, trying to figure out how to do something. It was crazy. And I completely bombed that interview, completely. And that really opened my eyes up to what kind of things you need to do to prepare for these types of interviews. So from that point on, I looked up, okay, like what is this type of question? You know, what are some resources? Cracking the coding interview, went to Udemy, got a bunch of courses. I started practicing daily, got like this whiteboard to practice with. And I kind of like just set up this schedule for myself to study consistently in order to be able to like pass these questions. So when it comes to negotiation, it's about what you're willing to accept and what they're willing to give. For example, if you have three offers from three different companies, and the first one comes out with a number, and the second one comes out with a higher number, you go back to the first company and you say, I had a better offer from this other company, and then they give you more money. So nothing else changed besides the fact that you got another offer. That makes it real clear how it's not about what you're worth. Paid what you can negotiate. Seeing I've heard from recruiters is that for whatever reason, and this is similar between women and also minorities, that they don't sell themselves as good as other groups, or they don't go for opportunities as good as other groups as well. Another thing is money. Like statistically speaking, there's a wealth gap between races. So black people make less. So you know less black people who make a lot of money. You know, for me, when I got my job offer, it was more than my immediate family mates added together. All up. So it was like, there's no way I was even thinking I could be able to negotiate or that it wasn't enough. Meanwhile, I could have gotten like 1.5 times more. So I would suggest always negotiate if you get an offer, because these companies, they can pay, you know, there's a cap to what they would pay just to keep things standard, but there's a huge range. Like somebody at the bottom of the range can get six figures less than somebody at the top of the range. A lot of times people would get asked to give them a number. I suggest you don't give a number because that sets the baseline for what they want to offer. That's one mistake I made. Like when I joined Uber in 2015, I gave my number from companies that weren't as like high level, and they kind of based it on that. They like kind of matched part of it or something like that. Like gave double amount, which is crazy because it was still high for me. It was still way too low. And also interview with other companies. Make sure you get other offers to compete so that you know you get the best deal. Like for one company may be a great fit, maybe not. You don't know until you finish the interview. And for two, it's always good to explore your options because you don't know what's out there. And then at the same time, you get these other offers to use to compete against. Then you can get more money, you can get a signing bonus or some other kind of perks that make it easier to accept the offer. So today I would definitely recommend like a boot camp. I feel like all the things that I learned, I could have did it faster if I wasn't just self-taught. If you have a direct guide that tells you do this, do that, do this, you don't waste years and years, you just do it in a few months. The problem I had with CS degrees, even back then, I don't see the value in spending so much time and money on all these other courses that aren't related to your major. It doesn't make any sense to me at all. So boot camps, which are very specific and focused, make a lot of sense because you're trying to learn software engineering, makes sense to focus on that. And also, the programs are kind of more outdated in colleges for whatever reason. Like they're kind of slower to adopt to newer things. And boot camps focus on the practical things and things you're going to be doing at work at the time. So like I think for many reasons, boot camps are actually better. As far as like long-term goals, just the core goal is financial freedom. And then once I reach that, my mindset will be a lot different. I'm not sure what exactly I'm going to do. You know, it's even the case, maybe I'll stay in full-time for a little bit more, who knows? You never really know when you get there. But most likely, definitely, I'm gonna create my own startup at some point. I'm not sure exactly what it's gonna be or, you know, what field it's gonna be. A lot of things can change, but a core goal I have is just reaching financial freedom. And I have a goal for 2023 to reach that.